Let's stand and pray. Lord, hear my prayer.
And let my heart come unto thee.
Heavenly Father, bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts, that they be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Be sit. Okay. So, the topic tonight is dating versus courtship.
None of us knew that.
Yes.
Sorry, I didn't mean
to. I tell you, this has been actually on my heart to speak about from the first day, but I felt like I had to lay some groundwork before we got to this in regards to the human heart and a couple of other things. There was one Sunday where I wasn't actually purposely moving towards this. I can't remember, it was a couple ago, where I can't remember what the subject was.
Near the hour?
Near the hour, yeah. Thank you. The near the hour, that was not in line with this. That was just something that that came up that I felt I needed to say. Or needed to be said. Mm-hmm. But we are here at the kind of a crossroads, kind of a symbolum, if you will, of what we have been talking about in our time together. And there are so many different, like a gemstone, there are so many different facets to this, so many different ways to strike this in order to make it, say, you know, into a princess cut, something perfect. And I'm at a little bit of a loss as to where to begin, but I think that the best thing that we should probably do is begin with defining our terms. Okay.
Have hope.
Yeah. So what is it that I'm saying when I say dating, and what is it that I'm saying when I say courtship? Because for most. I would say that these terms are interchangeable in our culture, meaning the same thing. Okay, for most people, in or outside the church. As a matter of fact, most folks would just say, "Well, this is kind of an antiquated way of saying this." All right. But I want you to know nothing could be further from the truth. Okay, when I say verses, I do mean verses. This is one thing, and this is another thing, which is entirely different. Okay? Let's begin by talking about the goal, the end product of each of these. So, remember, follow me. I'm defining terms, okay? And one of the ways that you can define something, Plato and Aristotle, and of course, through them, Augustine and Aquinas, tell us is by talking about the essence of what they are, okay? And the essence is not, sometimes it's in the function, but sometimes it's just in the end, okay? The goal of it, okay? Not the process, all right? So, what is the difference as far as the goal of these two things are concerned in the way in which I'm defining them, okay? And when I say me, I mean people like me. I'm not the only one. As a matter of fact, it was quite interesting. I typed in dating versus courtship into YouTube. Wow! Blew up everywhere. So I'm not alone in this. Okay. So the goal of courtship is marriage. Is it just marriage?
No, it's children.
Well, that's true. We're gonna assume that marriage and children equal the same thing, all things being equal. It is, and you girls are gonna like this.
Why are we like each other?
No, a speedy marriage.
Oh, yeah. Okay, I see.
It is moving to this okay? How would we describe it? In a route step march, to borrow a term from the Marine Corps. So in the Marine Corps, you can march, right? You know, and it's forward march, and 30 steps with the left foot. So forward march, left, right, and that's how you march. And there's a cadence to it. Left, right, left, right.
We no longer call it round step, but yeah.
If you want to move out, you might double time that march. So double time march, and at that point it's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but it's still in time. If you really want to move out, you go route step march, and everyone just walks as fast as they can. And if you're less than 6 feet tall, you're in a jog. No joke. This is seriously 3.5 miles per hour moving out. Okay. The idea is that marriage is in view, and marriage in the relative near future. Not marriage 4 years from now. Marriage 4 months from now. Marriage 6 months from now. Now we'll get to why this is, but the goal here is not marriage like someday. It's like marriage like we're moving on with this. We're getting married. Okay? Yeah.
I forgot my question.
Okay, let me go for about 20 minutes before we take questions. Give me 20 minutes. Right. So, dating on the other hand, now there could be some disagreement with this, okay? But as I define it, dating on the other hand doesn't really have a specific goal like that. But you could define it as fun.
/pleasure.
I was reading St. Alphonsus Liguori this week, actually. Thank you, Sandra, for putting me on this guy. And he actually wrote quite a bit about courtship and dating, and so did the Pope, and they kind of had a conversation about this, and there were sermons about this, and boy, St. John Vianney, whoo! You don't want to hear what he said about dancing. Or, oh my.
Yeah.
We just want to avoid that all together. Okay? But anyway.
What does he say about it?
Oh, he's
he does not like dancing at all.
Not for it at all.
Not for dancing?
Okay, let's move on. We're not talking about dancing tonight. And St. John Vianney. Although St. John Vianney does lend some voice to this conversation. But fun, pleasure. Check this out. Back in the day, and this is what somebody asked him. He says, well, Can't we go out and make love? Now, what he meant by that, okay, in old Italian, okay, love making, is not what we mean by love making, but I thought it was really funny and actually kind of instructive, because what he meant by love making was romance. To make love, not the conjugal sense of it, but the sense of making a romance, and that they would purposely go and do that. These young Italian men, these young Italian ladies, back in the late 1400s, not time of the Reformation. That's when St. Alphonsus Liguori lived. So, lovemaking, or in common parlance, romance. That's kind of the goal of dating. Courtship, the goal is marriage. And movement to marriage, like a movement to contact. I can't kind of get out of the record for some reason. But anyway, getting on with it, as it were, as opposed to playing around. Okay. Now, there are some other differences. That's the difference in the goal. Now, I don't want to speak for people. Although I would argue that the vast majority of young ladies, as I've just described this, would probably prefer this than this. Okay. It didn't say that there were young women coming to St. Alphonsus and asking about this. It was young men saying, "Can't we do this?" Okay. And we'll get on to a discussion about feminism and who actually started feminism a little bit later on. But it wasn't women. And it wasn't deliberate.
well, kind of liberated from my walls. Anyway, okay, so dating and courtship, that's the goal, the as we're defining it. Let's talk about how we get there. Okay, now, because this is not particularly defined, we'll put this back up here. How we get there is going to be a little bit more difficult to deal with. How we get here, okay. Now this is going to seem a little bit strange. For the first, 5,000 years of human history, up until about 100 years ago, people in general, not always, but in general, would, if they were having brains at all, would pursue this not with their emotions. They would not lead with their emotions. They would lead with their heads. Okay? And we can get into a whole reason why that is, and and we will in a second. But the bottom line is that because this is such a big, momentous decision, marriage are vows like priestly vows. Okay? They are lifelong. Alright? Despite the fact that you see the destruction of marriage everywhere around you, that is simply not the case. Okay? And the big hurrah in the church right now has to deal with four cardinals who are dealing with some confusion on that issue as well. You saw our bishop step up, write a letter, and say, we're not doing that. Marriage is still forever. Okay? And currently, we do not have a tribunal. So, a tribunal is where people go to the church and say, hey, I was never validly married. And I don't know what the complaint is, because if you saw the amount of the percentage of people that actually apply for an annulment and the ones that get it, I mean, and it's free now. Seriously, it's despicable. Okay. You go at this with your head, not with your heart. Okay. And the reason why is because Monday morning. I used to say this to a person a long time ago, and it's still true today. Life is mundane, okay? Or life is the mundane, okay? Married life, yes, you have a honeymoon, and yes, you have anniversaries, and yes, there is romance in it. But the truth of the matter is that once the thrill and all the chemicals wear off of your brain, you're actually married to a person who wakes up in the morning with no makeup on, whose breath smells bad, who just blew up your bathroom, who, that's reality. Wait until your husband goes into the delivery room. I mean, man, let me tell you something, romance is out the window, okay? It's just life, and it's messy, and it's difficult, and you're chained to a sinner. The person that you just married.
I gotta hold up this.
That is
it. Yes,
your marriage.
Huh? You're killing their marriage ideals.
Yeah.
Oh, am I?
I didn't mean to
blow up the family.
Dad's gonna become a nun now.
Become a nun.
No,
be a priest.
Be nicer.
Like that, 98% of you being married, that's all there is to it.
But okay. Why don't you tell them that it's still nice sometimes, though?
Yes, it's nice sometimes. Okay, so
benefits, but if you're just like suffering reaps its benefits, yeah. And its joys, it's suffering, so it's not.
I guess what I'm trying to say is that it can, you know, there's always going to be difficulties, okay? And you have to do whatever you can to minimize those difficulties. Okay, let me start throwing out some illustrations.
Guys,
here's one. Just disparity of lifestyle in growing up. somebody grows up really well off, somebody grows up really, really poor, okay, and they get married, and what is that going to look like? Okay?
One's a gold digger?
Huh?
One's a gold digger?
I'm serious, I'm actually, is that what his point is?
No, it's the clash of both.
Yeah, it's the issue over, okay, we're gonna follow this down, I'll get there in a second. The point is that the way they view wealth or money or money is going to be totally different. Conflict is bound to happen. Okay? Bound to happen. The guy who grew up poor or the girl who grew up poor is going to be super, super frugal. Even if hubby makes a boatload of money, she or he won't want to spend it because that's the way they grew up. They're not going to want to go to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse for their anniversary because a $35 steak a la carte, probably $45 steak a la carte, and a $15 baked potato, and a...
Yep. Actually, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Okay, and a $14 glass of wine, not saying the $100 bottle of wine that hubby really wants to buy or wifey really wants to get, and that's on the low end of their red wine list. Okay. It's anniversary, man. You're laughing, yeah, okay, well, that's maybe the way you grew up. But, you know, other people may have been like, you know, that's the way they, you know, no, I'm not joking on you. I'm just saying. Do you see what I'm saying? That's funny to you. You're like, that's insane. Okay? And if you make a ton of money, you still won't want to do that. But wifey who grew up in daddy doctor's house is like, feeling utterly deprived. More than that, she's hurt. No, stop. This is not funny. She is torn up because he is so cheap and doesn't love her and doesn't care about her.
Sorry.
It's not funny. They're up in an office yelling and screaming at each other. Do you know what marriage counselor? I knew a marriage counselor one time. He's a Protestant, but he was a good dude. He'd walk in. Listen.
Okay.
This is what they say. He'd say, tell me about that and tell me about that. That's all I want to hear about. That's all I want to hear about. Because you know what? That blows up more homes than you can shake a stick at. Sex and money. That's it.
I'm losing my
energy. Do you see? I know I'm making it sound horrible and difficult, but I'm telling you, there will be moments in your married life where it will be horrible and difficult. And you had better be in it with a girl or a guy. Got that wrong. Okay. That is as close to you as possible. And I mean in the way that they view the world, in the way that they think about things, in their values, okay? These are not things that are like, oh, this person's a Christian and this person's not a Christian. I'm talking about good Catholic people laughing at the idea that somebody would take his wife out for a $500 dinner on their anniversary, and another girl thinking to herself, he doesn't love me, because he's clearly got $200,000 in the bank, and I'm not worth $500 of it? Ouch. For real, ouch. You see what I'm saying? Nope, not yet. Okay? This is the kind of stuff that I'm talking about. This is the kind of stuff that has to be reasonably fair. Now, I'm just taking little swipes at it. These are just... easy illustrations. I can give you tons and tons of, you know, psychological heirlooms that people have to inherit from mom and dad, well, from other people's moms and dads, okay, that you may want to just know about before you jump into that, okay? Is he or she a clean freak? Now, I say it that way, okay, because obviously I'm not. Okay, but is he a slob? Okay, but you see, even how I describe it is pejorative, right? Because that's the way people feel. Okay? And, you know, I know the emotions aren't necessarily reality, but emotions they play a large part in who you are. God wouldn't have given you them if they didn't. He certainly wants you to use them when you're in adoration. Right? So you have to pay attention to these kinds of things, and even the emotional issues.
Okay.
There's, the list goes on. As a matter of fact, these are two books. The ABCs of Choosing a Good Husband. And the ABCs of Choosing a Good Wife.
We had a book.
You? Now, if you decide to date, alright. Why bother reading a book, man? Why are you gonna bother reading a book if you're gonna throw your heart into the ring long before you ever start thinking about what you're doing? Because you won't think about what you're doing.
Pay attention.
If you've done this, hey, if you've done this, okay, then if you're here, you're not gonna think about this. You're not going to think about anything. You're not going to make a reasoned decision about anything. Thank you. Do you understand? And all the books in the world, you know, you're going to look at that book, you know, and you're going to be like, yeah, he's great, he's great, he's great, he's great. Right? You're going to sit there and honestly, your heart is entwined. You're gonna rip that out? I don't think so.
No.
If you're already not yet. If you're already down here, if you're already down here, okay, you are not gonna do this and say, see ya. It's not gonna happen. It will not happen. That is why you have to make a reasoned decision. You have to. Real quick.
You're saying, so just to clarify, you're saying that throwing away the books, that's something that someone
that's
would do when they're
putting
in too much emotion? You're saying that's what someone would do when they're putting in too much emotion?
Yeah.
Just doing something like that? Okay.
Yeah.
Because that's literally the most
powerful
thing you can do.
Everyone really thought it was cool when I brought the books out. I guarantee you, the dudes were like, oh yeah, checklist for a wife, not a bad idea. The girls were like, oh, checklist for a husband, not a bad idea. And because nobody's in love, at least I think, in here, okay?
No one's
so,
a no list.
And so you're all okay with it. If I had a room full of couples, and I was giving this right now, unmarried dating couples, they'd be going out the window if they could go out the window. They don't want to hear this. They do not want to hear this. And they certainly don't want the girl or guy sitting next to them to start believing this. Because then their little heart's going to be broken. You don't want that. You don't want any part of that. No part of that. Okay? Not yet. Thank you. Is it driving you nuts?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
It doesn't. No, it's driving me nuts because it's dripping on me.
Oh, yeah. You want to clean the board off real quick? That'd be great. You want me to clean the board off real quick? Okay. All right. So, there are a zillion illustrations, and those books are great illustrators.
They are
the great illustrators of the kinds of things you want to look for. Okay, let's talk about the mechanics of this a little bit. Okay, in dating, the mechanics are pretty simple. Dude sees girl he likes, or maybe girl sees dude she likes. I mean, all bets are off towards propriety at this point, right? Sadie Hawkins is run amok. And, gosh, nobody got that.
I did!
Homeschoolers.
I got it!
Anyway, so poor old Sadie. So they just, they find each other. And if they're Christians, they promise not to, go too terribly far. And maybe they do, maybe they don't, I tell you what, though, the reason why this is You know why it's that way?
Because we don't.
Because they always hold on everything.
Right. Right.
Sorry.
And it's a recognition of the fact that you put two young, beautiful people together for too terribly long.
And if your health
is. They will do what they do. Okay? They will begin to act like married people. Not good. Not good. Okay? So it's an honest recognition of the fact that what will happen here is love, marriage, and sex. Okay? Just honest. That's all it is. This over here is, oh, we're just going to have a good time. You know? Promises of nothing. Except we're just going to have a good time. You know? The mechanics of this, on the other hand, as opposed to this, involve this dreaded man.
Oh, no.
Dad. It involves Dad. That can involve mom as well, but the primary mover and shaker in this is boy and girl. That's not up here, but boy and girl, and dad. Okay. Why dad? Well, there's a reason why. Because the boy, the man, comes to Courtland, needs to have an understanding with her father. Okay? An understanding that can only be arrived at between two men. That is, you touch my daughter, I break your arms. It's just that simple. Okay? Feminism was given birth to by modernity. Okay? So first you had the Enlightenment, which gave birth to modernity. Modernity gave birth to all kinds of putrid filth. One of the movements that came out of it, and there's many philosophical, political, artistic, just everything. It got its tentacles into everything modernity did, okay? Well, one of the things it got into is into societal thought, and one of the societal thoughts was, okay, well, first and foremost, that we are all evolved from some common ape-like ancestor, okay, in the idea of evolution, all right? And then if we're all animals, well then, you know, we can act like, you know, animals. There's nothing moral or immoral about a particular behavior. I remember one time watching this fascinating program, this old English dude who seemed very, very proper and was the Royal Academy of Science, the one institution that has promoted evolution for the past, you know, 150 years. And he was he's dead now. This is back when I was in college and he was old then. This guy was born like 1900, okay? And he was asked, what great thing has the theory of evolution accomplished? Do you know his answer? This old dude, born in 1900 and in 1980-something, is giving this answer. And he said, it freed us up sexually. You're thinking that this great scientist from the Royal Academy of Science talking about the theory of evolution would have something a little bit more enlightened than if he sounded like a hippie, okay, at Woodstock. But of course, that is the point. That's exactly what they wanted. If we're animals, we can act like animals. Now, feminism comes out, okay, and who starts feminism? I'll tell you who. Remember we were talking about these boys that have to meet with dad? Well, they're actually men to boys. Anyway, okay? You know what they want to do? They want to separate daughter from dad so that they can have illicit sex with her. And thus, feminism is born. You're free, baby! Free from pop! Strip her away from her family, away from the protection of her father, so that you can have your way with her. The triumph of feminism. Yay. Pathetic. And that's the world. You want to see people rail against this, against patriarchy? Because this is patriarchal, dude. I mean, dad in charge of who we marry. Whoa, sister. Okay. Let me tell you something. That is going to be something that is just going to be absolutely blown up. Okay. Well, we haven't gotten through half of it yet, and we're done.
See you next time.
I just knew this wouldn't happen. Okay. All right. Questions? We haven't even gotten halfway. It's cool. They'll be part two next time.
So, just to be clear, you are being discussed solely on your terms of dating courtship, right?
Well, it's not just mine, but yes.
Based off of his understanding of the church's terms of courtship. Because what he's saying is literally word for word what I've heard from almost any person whose head is worth looking at. In a sense, or listening to.
Now, when she says what the church teaches, I'm talking about what the church has historically taught, but not magisterial level teaching.
Yeah.
Okay. But yet, at the same time, was just common knowledge. Unfortunately, no one thought to codify this in the magisterium. Okay. Because.
Not too terribly long ago, it was a shame to do something.
Yeah, it was never an issue. It was so ingrained in every society in the world. As a matter of fact. In my lifetime, and in Sandra's lifetime, this is what was done, not in America, but in most countries in the world. Sandra can remember in Colombia that this was commonplace. A daughter was protected by other men from her by her dad.
Can I tell you?
Sure.
Yeah, let me tell you. I was living in this country. Mm-hmm. I got married at 22. I was 21, and I still needed a chaperone. My parents would not let me come visit Luis here when we were getting our license. To be able to take it to the church to get married. And I had to come here. I had to come with my cousin. Because it was like that. And I just was okay with it because that's how I grew up. So I would come here at 21 to get our license, whatever, so we can get married in the church. And I had to come with a chaperone. So,
right.
Heads up.
So this is not... This is not craziness, okay? It's craziness to you, to not only you, but to me. You grew up like this. I was born in 1965, man. I mean, Woodstock took place, what, about 4 years ago, when I was 4 years old? I mean, I don't remember. I mean, it was nothing but dating. I never heard the word courtship until I was 30 years old. I did not do it. Surprise, surprise. That's a shocker. Okay, so you know, don't be shocked that this seems foreign and countercultural, and it will be. You will be a weirdo. Well, you know, welcome to Christianity.
I was singing because I wasn't there.
So, and that'll be on tape forever. So anyway, go ahead.
I wanted to point out that I think the church doesn't have anything against the theory of evolution. It's just ideas that people attach to it, correct?
Yeah, that's probably the official teaching of the church.
What is? I think
you can hold to it in some sort of fashion.
Yeah, I don't think the church has anything wrong with it, but it's just that people often attach certain ideas with that. I think Darwin was an atheist.
I think we need to define a lot of terms there, but we're a little bit off topic. But we'll circle around to that sometime. But it would need a lot more defining. Okay. Anyway, on any more questions about courtship and marriage? Like I said, this is like part one. Okay. Yeah.
But what exactly do you mean when you say church? Like, I know you're saying not like...
I'm saying like Alphonsus Liguori and...
It's a mortal sin to have sex before
Pius
marriage,
the 12th,
right?
Huh?
That's a teaching, that it's a mortal sin to have sex before marriage.
Yeah, that's a teaching.
He's going based off of that. In order not to have sex before marriage, you have to protect the occasion of sin that leads to sex before marriage, which
right.
is...
And the church, the church did allow... Actually, this is the Pope did allow... Now, again, this is a Pope speaking, not ex cathedra. The Pope did allow for this, but called it an occasion for sin. But a necessary occasion for sin. Courtship! Because even that was dangerous, okay? Considered, you know, relatively dangerous. You know? Now, I don't know how much if they in Italy in the 1400s, they allowed for these people to be alone. I don't think they did. I don't think in the 1400s you'd let your daughter out and be alone. okay? But it was called a necessary occasion for sin. Okay, so do you understand what an occasion for sin is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, fellas, looking at something inappropriate, okay, may not be a sin. Right? But it's 99.9% of the time it's attached to it. So you call that a near occasion for sin. You see what I'm saying? Like we were talking about the other day, going to the beach. Going to the beach is an occasion for sin, and it's not a necessary occasion for sin for most guys. So I would say don't go to the beach. You see what I'm saying?
He's talking about for sensitive, healthy young men. There is a lot of background for the young men of today because they are really messed up. They actually aren't attracted. That's why you have so many problems issues going on with the whole transgender thing. It's because people genuinely aren't attracted to that.
I guess weird. Okay.
Yeah, a whole other topic.
Anyway, we're talking about occasion for sin, and the idea was that courtship was considered a necessary occasion for sin. Okay? And that was a teaching of a pope.
But that wasn't like official?
No, it wasn't magisterial.
So when you say about teaching the church non-magisterial, do you just mean like priests trying to give their own personal opinion?
Alphonsus Liguori. Well, I wouldn't say that they're giving their
saints
giving their own personal opinions and popes giving their own personal opinions.
Not just any random.
So it's yes, you can totally blow me off, Gloria. Okay, based on that, do you really want to go there? No. Okay, so let's not go down that line any longer because that's not helpful.
Well, I don't think you understand the reasoning behind it and why you're saying what you're saying. Like, send us also the explanation.
He's a doctor of the church.
Well, this might help you. Yeah. Well, this might help you.
There's only like
holding
four
hands,
of them.
Okay. San Alfonso says it's against
four
holding
doctor.
Hands.
No,
it's holding hands wrong.
Yeah.
Is holding hands wrong?
No.
No.
Not inherently.
Not inherently. Thank you. Holding hands. If you're holding hands with your brother, with your sister, with your dad, with your mom, with your uncle, your cousin, that's nothing. If you're holding hands at, we're playing a game and everybody's holding hands, that's not a sin. If you like the person you're holding hands with, really like the person you're holding hands with, it incites passion of some sort. And that's when the sin can get in. It's not inherently a sin. It's an unnecessary occasion for sin. It's a door that can open. And it's only like, is kissing a sin? No. And I can, when I say house plants, people say hello, we give a kiss on the cheek. Italians give two kisses. Everybody in every culture, that's not sinful. Now, if, let's say I was, I liked Mr. Rosa before getting married, and I kissed him. Even if it's just a little peck in the mouth, it will incite a passion that is only doable for a married couple. That's where the problem was going to be again. So that's the kind of, does that make sense? Does that help you a little
healthy,
bit?
You really can't help sometimes.
I don't know.
Right, that's why you wouldn't do that. Okay, because it would be an unnecessary occasion for sin.
So then maybe we shouldn't, at the youth group, maybe we shouldn't be playing games like Christians and Romans where we're holding hands.
Well,
to
not everyone likes
other.
Well, that's
the person
what I'm saying. It has to be.
Yeah.
I mean,
we
you need to stay away from
yeah.
that.
Yeah, but you don't know who you like to here, and like.
I can't say anything.
Well, if you have a problem, then don't.
I think everyone's known each other so long, the like.
I would say,
that's something that person
not,
themselves, based on the right decision, needs to either move, or if they genuinely just don't care about the person.
And they're not holding hands
right.
like lovey-dovey
yeah.
holding hands. They're dragging them to prison.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
not holding hands.
I would prefer to make everyone else not play just because two people might like each other.
But if you feel like you're the kind
if
of
if you feel like that's
right.
that's bothering you,
then don't play. And that would be a very
that'd be a very wise and mature thing
to
do
know
in
that you can control yourself enough.
Yeah.
That if you know that there's a girl that you particularly like, to get yourself away from that occasion of sin,
right.
then just don't play.
And there's nothing wrong with that. As a matter of fact, it shows spiritual maturity, not
exactly.
immaturity.
Mm-hmm. Even in this environment, you don't have much opportunity to act on your occasions.
But it is something that
yeah.
needs to be a personal choice in that person. You can't.
Yeah,
you can't
yeah,
force
yeah.
people.
You
can't
yeah,
force
I mean,
right.
I think. I
like,
guess.
I think
I guess
you
we're
like
all
that
agreeing
person.
It's not. it's kind of unnecessary.
We have free choice, and there's two things we can choose: the fire or the water.
Right.
It's our choice ultimately.
Right.
You can't yeah. force someone to stick their hands in the water.
Okay. What time?
It's late. It's almost been an hour.
It's 26.
Let's
get it. I don't do that.
Lord, hear my prayer.
Let my pride come to thee.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day that you have given us, 1 in 7, that we might rest and worship you. We pray for Father as he is down at Lake Nona. Watch over, bless, and protect him as he is traveling back to his home, as we pray this. May his guardian angel guard him and deliver him safely home. We pray, Lord, for each of us and each of these young ones here, that you would watch over and protect them on their journey home this evening. Guard and protect them. We pray that you would bless the talk, the discussion that we had this evening, that you would allow it, if it would be your will, to prick the hearts of those to whom you most desire to have it speak, and that if anything was said that is not of you, may it be like water poured upon rocks, which cannot be gathered. We ask, Lord, that you would bless the food that we're about to eat. We ask that you would bless it to us at our use, and us to thy service, and that we would be ever mindful of the needs of others. All of this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.